goes to the office or to the family gatherings, talking about their spouses, saying what you were doing over the weekend, what you're planning to do in the summer holidays. And I could never say, Johan and I are doing so-and-so, planning whatever. So it was very important to me to say, Johan and I, on the cover of the book. Actually, it's my... Thank you. It was book number 12. I have now written 15, and 14 have been published, so it's one of many books, but it is extremely, obviously, important to me. And I want to tell you a little bit about what's inside, because it's only available in Icelandic and Danish as yet, so I can't... The story starts in 1983, when I was around 30 and Johanna was around 40. And I will show you some photos from the book as stepping stones. I will try not to speak too much, I could talk all night. So I'm supposed to do something if I want a picture. Yes. you can see who's sitting in the middle with white hair. That's obviously Johanna, that's her place, always in front of the middle. This is where we met. This was really strange. We are very different people and we move in different circles, and I was very much away from politics. And for some strange reason, which is too long to go into here, I got elected as what we call in Iceland an alternate MP, meaning I was like the substitute, so if the proper MP got ill, as he did once, then I would step in and be MP, and I was there just for 2 weeks. And I was appointed to, through this party that I belong to, I was appointed to this committee. This is Johanna's committee, obviously. It's about women's equal pay. And I had no interest in equal pay, I had no interest in politics, and I didn't, you know, want to be there. And if you haven't seen me yet, that's no surprise, because I'm the one who's been overdoing the sunbeds. Number 3 from the back, look very dark. It was at the time before we knew that sunbeds were not really good for your skin. And I went to this committee not really wanting to be there, not being interested in equal pay or anything. And then all of a sudden I started getting so excited about going to these meetings. I know, the bell didn't ring and I was just looking, I was counting the hours until the next meeting. And I didn't realize what was going on, and my 30th birthday was coming up, and my mother told me the family is going to give you one of those electric mixers so you can make cakes. And I said, no, I'm a politician now, I go to meetings, I need a briefcase. My family gave me this lovely red briefcase to take to these meetings, full of, you know, nothing. It looked really good. And then I started to try and analyze. I must add that I was married, I had a young son, and Johanna was married, and she obviously to men. This was 1983 to 1985. And she had 2 sons. And it had never occurred to me that I would fall in love with somebody of the same sex. So it took me a long time, many, many months, to realize what's going on with me. And I decided I must try and speak to her, because gradually I realized the feelings, I'm looking forward to these meetings, it's all because of Johanna. And it feels really much like being in love, but it can't be, obviously, but still, I must try and talk to her and see if she, you know, is feeling anything similar. So the committee that we belong to sent 2 women all around Iceland to speak to local women about, obviously, equal pay. And the woman who was going with Johanna phoned at the last minute saying, I can't go. And I said, I'll do it. So I was jumping with joy, but I was also really scared, because I didn't know her at all. I had never heard her speak about anything except equal pay. And we have never talked, and only once when she was leaving the one of these gatherings, she put her hand on my back, and I could feel it for days afterwards. So I decided I need some courage. So I went to a local shop, and I was so ridiculously old-fashioned, I bought a bottle of sherry to take with me for courage, because I was so lucky that Johanna was going to speak at a meeting where they only had one flight per day, so we had to stay in a hotel together overnight, which I was looking forward to. And so I took a bottle of sherry, and after the meeting, we went to Johanna's hotel room, and I was going to speak about my feelings, but it took about 2 hours and a lot of sherry. And I was still not saying anything. And then it was obvious that she wanted me to leave and she was going to sleep. She was yawning. So I told her, there's something going on with me. I look so forward to meeting you and I don't know what's happening. It's never happened to me before. And she was, you know, with a poker face, didn't say anything. Just, your secret is safe with me. That's how it started. And obviously nothing happened, and I was very, I said something terrible, because I obviously didn't know what am I going to do if she comes running and saying, oh, let's kiss or something. So I said, if you think about kissing me or something, I might go to the toilet and throw up. Because I didn't know what I was talking about, you know, it was all so new. So we started meeting, and after this, she started taking me with her to meet the Minister of Finance, because we needed money to publicize everything about women's equal pay. And gradually we got to know each other, and this the thing with the hotel and the sherry was in April 1985, and I got divorced in the summer because I knew this is what I was feeling, and whatever, even if she doesn't want me, I'm still gonna get divorced, because I knew that I wanted to be with her and I was willing to wait, but I had no idea I was gonna have to wait for 15 years. It was rather long. If anybody had told me 15 months, I would have thought it's too long, but that's how it was. So let's have another photo. And we'll be quicker now. You saw a huge gathering in the video clip. It's a women's, we had a women's strike. Women went on strike in Iceland 3 times actually. And this is down in the center of Reykjavik. Johan and I, this is the first photograph that was taken of us together. The other one was later. And this is us at the party. And we were just mingling as friends. And nobody knew that we were a couple, and we started, Johanna also got divorced, and we were traveling together and always just pretending to be friends. Okay, we're going very fast. I thought I could say when I wanted another photo. Maybe you will stop the photos now? Okay, I was just gonna tell you that we had 15 very turbulent years in the closet. I did a lot of crying, I did a lot of slamming doors, and I left, and I came back the next day, and then I left again. And it was just very, very difficult, because we had these small boys, and Johanna was in politics, obviously, and didn't want to change her career. We were worried that something would happen to her career. We got a book, somebody gave us a book about a Norwegian politician, another Nordic politician, a woman who came out in Oslo with her partner, and she lost her parliamentary seat immediately afterwards. So we knew it's not going to be easy. But then gradually our friends started to know about this, and our family. We didn't tell anyone, we didn't come out. But during those years, people gradually started realizing what was happening, our close friends and our family. And I can tell you a little story about my mother, she hated alcohol. She never drank, as she didn't want anyone else to drink. And then I was living in the same house as my parents. I had a different flat, and I was a single parent with my son. And my mother and my father, they saw Johanna coming on Friday and not leaving until Sunday, and they never talked about it. And they saw me leave on Friday and come back on Sunday, and they never asked, you know, what have you been doing? They knew I was going to see Johanna. And then one day my mother, when I came home from Johanna's, she said, your father and I, we have been discussing this, and we've been wondering, is this a romantic relationship? And I said, yes. And then my mother said, oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. Your father and I were hoping you were just drinking together. So that would have been preferable to my mother. But slowly, like Johanna said, this a small group of people who established the LGBT association, they changed the attitudes in Iceland while Johanna was working on other things, changing a lot of things in Parliament, and I was writing my books, and I was a journalist. And in the year 2000, our boys had left home, and we finally started living together. And it was fantastic. It had been a long wait, and we were really happy. And we were going to live this very, very private, you know, private life, just the two of us. And obviously, as Johanna is well known in Iceland, the media started asking for interviews because they knew we were living together. And we said, sorry, we just want our nice little life together. We don't want to be in the media. And Iceland is a small country, everybody knows each other, and they were kind and said, okay, we'll leave you alone. And this was how it was. We entered a civil partnership, which we celebrated on the way here yesterday. It was in 2002 on the 15th of June. So we had a little champagne in Copenhagen Airport yesterday to celebrate. Because we changed our civil partnership to marriage on the 27th, we have two celebrations in June, which is very nice. So we have what we have been waiting for all this while, just our little home life, everybody happy, nobody making an issue of this, and Johanna was in politics, no problem. And just privacy, peace, and respect. And then we had the crisis, and Johanna became prime minister. And then everything changed just in, you know, 1 hour. All of a sudden we started getting, you know, attention from all over the world because of our relationship, because Johanna was the first openly gay head of state. So we could no longer say, don't talk about us, don't write about us, we want privacy. And we just, obviously Johanna had a lot to do. She more or less left home for a few years to be in the office and save Iceland. But we did have a few engagements. And you can see on this photo, I'm on the far left, these are the spouses of the Prime Minister of the Nordic countries. They always meet every year with their spouses in a relaxed situation. So wherever we went, everything was really, you know, respectful, and nobody was making an issue of us being two women. So it was wonderful and better than we had hoped for. And now maybe we can have another picture of Johanna playing with her grandchildren. This is Christmas, and there are more grandchildren now. There are 8 altogether. And this is a rare occasion. Most of the kids only knew her, you know, only met her, you know, at very special occasions. And they saw her on television more than they did at home. And maybe the next photo is from, this is an official visit that we went to the Faroe Islands. The Faroe Islands are governed by Denmark, and they are a very typical Nordic country, but the only time we met with any, you know, difficulties is on this visit, because there was this member of parliament who didn't want to come and have dinner. You always have official dinners in these visits. And he didn't want to sit down and have dinner with us because we were a gay couple. And the people of the Faroe Islands, they were really sorry about this. This is the Prime Minister and his wife. They didn't have an LGBT association back then, and it was a very oppressed people left to Denmark who were gay in the Faroe Islands. but only a few weeks after, this caused a lot of attention, our visit and the rudeness of the MP who didn't want to have dinner with us. Only a few weeks later, they established an LGBT association. Now they have annual gay parades, and they are, even have civil partnership as of just a few weeks ago. So everything has changed. Another photo. Yeah, this you may know Santi Toksvig, who's on the left. If you know QI, the TV program with Stephen Fry, she is taking over as host later this year, and we got to know her through my writing, not Johanna, amazing. Okay, another one. Now I will be quick. This is from another official visit. We went to Beijing, the Prime Minister of Iceland visiting the Prime Minister of China, which was an unbelievable experience. We didn't know how things would be, because obviously they have completely different views of gay rights, but they were extremely polite, everything was really courteous, and we had a lovely visit there. And we have some more photos from that, I think. Yeah, there's Johanna on the red carpet with the Prime Minister of China, and the, you know, the honors of, and everything, the a proper official visit. We got a lot of reaction from people in China, LGBT people who sent messages saying how important this was for them, because having been maybe thrown out of their families, whatever, they can take the newspaper and show their family, see our Prime Minister is being polite and accepting a visit from another Prime Minister who has a same-sex partner. Okay, I think we'll be quick now. This is also in China, it's taken from afar, so this is on the red carpet, the Prime Minister of China, Johanna, and myself just about to walk into the official banquet. And another one. That's the official banquet. You can see Johanna's white hair everywhere. So it's obvious where she is, and the Prime Minister is behind her, by her side, and then I'm on the other side. So everything was done properly, like, you know, they showed us full respect. Another one, that's, I had a spouse program, of course, very proper, going to a university. Okay, another one, we're just coming to the end. This is Johanna protesting outside the Russian embassy. Now, obviously, she has retired, and this was not while she was Prime Minister, and now we are doing other things, and she was protesting the anti-gay laws outside the Russian embassy. That's just part of all the roses. We got, Johanna was given 1,000 red roses on her last day, as you saw in the video. That's us with some of the roses. And we're just coming to end. This is the board of the LGBT Association in Iceland giving her a bouquet, obviously of rainbow colored roses. And I think we're just about to end. Okay.